Hi, I'm Dr. Satish Kumar and this is Kaizen Dental. Our aim here is to help dentists succeed. Our subscribers and followers would know that we come up with content, how to grow your career after BDS regularly. These interviews are a part of a different segment in which you can listen to experienced dentists and learn from their journey as well as gain advice from them. So in today's video, we are going to interview Dr. Ashwin Javadekar. Our guest for today is Dr. Ashwin Javadekar. He's done his MDS from Mumbai, his MSc and Dental Public Health from London, PG Diploma from Hyderabad, Dental Practice Management from UK. He's also a fellow in Myofunctional Orthodontics from Andorra, a senior dental leader in Harvard, and has also done a certificate in clinical dental research methods from the University of Washington. Currently, he holds the following positions. He's a global ambassador for the Global Child Dental Fund. He's a professor and head in Bhartavidya Peeth Dental College and Hospital and the director in Little Smiles Childcare Private Limited. Other than these, he also is involved in a lot of extracurricular activities. For example, he's written and directed a short film known as All Is Wells. He's performed as a singer in various live concerts. He's composed two music albums and also composed music for a stage show. The IDA song for Maharashtra State Branch is also written and composed by him. We should actually have another session in which we discuss how does he manage his dental activities and his hobbies and interests. But since this entire session is towards pediatric dentistry, sir, my first question to you would be, what got you into pediatric dentistry? Was it by chance or by choice?
Well, as far as the post-graduation in pediatric dentistry was concerned, I was left with only that choice. So I didn't make that choice, but amongst the choices that I had, that one came to me. And because in those days, the admissions used to be on the basis of marks. And okay. I had some hopes in oral medicine, oral surgery, and pediatric dentistry. And the choice that I was left with, as I said, was pediatric dentistry. So I chose that one. But now, I mean, of course, I have absolutely no regrets about the choice that came to me. In fact, I always keep saying that success is not about getting what you like. It is about liking what you get.
And that is something we need to learn from.
Thereon.
That is a so really nice thing.
It's always true.
No, because you know, right now youngsters are focused on, yes. All are focused about passion. So that's a very different approach, sir.
Correct. But it's true. Even if you are passionate about something, for example, you are passionate about endodontics and you take up endodontics as your career, you may not be passionate about some other aspects of, say, business aspects of the career. So how good you are at those things which you do not like actually decide how successful you will be in the things that you like to do.
Actually, that leads me to my next question. That is, you were among the initial few who started exclusive pediatric dentistry practices. Even periodontists these days are very scared. If I put up exclusive practice, will I get patients? Will other people refer me those patients? Because there's this fear that if I send my patient to some other practice, an exclusive practice, will the patient come back? Mm. So how did you take that gutsy decision so many years ago? And what were the obstacles you faced?
Frankly, it was not a very difficult decision. Earlier, I had started a general dental practice with my wife because in those days I could afford only one clinic. So my wife is also a dentist. So we started one practice. But every day I wanted to think about an exclusive practice, and about a couple of years later that happened. Now about pediatric dentistry, it's a little different from any other specialty in dentistry because this is an age-defined specialty. It is not a procedure or a technique-specific specialty. Say, operative dentistry or conservative dentistry or endodontics or periodontology, your specialty. So they deal with certain procedures, certain techniques, Whereas pediatric dentistry is more age defined. Even as per the definition, it is an age defined specialty. Now, I know that I have to take my child to a pediatrician. I don't need to ask anybody about that. It's such an established thing now. You don't even consult a general practitioner before you go to a pediatrician for your child. So similarly, because my elder brother is a pediatrician, I realized that for a child dentist, they don't have to think twice if one is available. And I wanted that one to be available for them as a pediatric dentist. And there are other things also.
But were patients aware dentistry. That there were pediatric dentistry at that point of time? Because even now, patients think ki a general dentist does everything. Didn't you have that problem?
I mean, the answer is yes as well as no. Because it is you who have to make them aware about your presence, about your specialization, about your how you are likely to give them a different and another experience. And that's what, in fact, was missing in general dentistry. A pediatric dentist working in his or her own practice can really give a totally different experience to a child patient, which cannot happen in a general dental practice for a variety of reasons. Because there the focus is not pediatric dentistry. So right from the ambience of the clinic or the decor of that clinic to the protocols, to the expertise of the assistants, there are various things that pediatric dentists would want to do differently. And that comes as a separate concept. So it, I feel, requires a separate existence. And somehow my training and my understanding of pediatric dentistry and some of the experiences also working as a consultant in various dental clinics. In fact, I often say I don't mean to show anyone or any practice in bad light, but what I learned from my visiting pediatric dentist practice was that what not to do in my own clinic. So, and that's what I'm saying, that many general dental practices, they are not really child friendly. So just to give you an example, if there is a glass partition between the operatory and the waiting area, and a child waiting outside on a cramped bench sitting next to an adult patient watches some extraction or something being done inside, and another child or even an adult crying and some blood tickling from the corner, blood coming down from
That'd
the corner.
That'd be a bad modeling.
So absolutely. So I don't consider that as a child-friendly dental clinic.
Understood.
So you, in order to give a child-friendly experience, in order to have a focus on pediatric dentistry, and I mean, for the reasons that I told you, that it is an age-defined specialty. So,
but didn't you find any problems when you started this? No difficulties or anything which you faced?
To my surprise, it was such a welcome idea even then. Okay. Initially, I would say that there was a resistance in terms of, well, maybe then I wouldn't practice preventive dentistry as much as I practice it now. Because often the patient was referred to me for a certain treatment, say endodontic treatment of a certain tooth. Or people came to me only after there was a lot of pain, or there was with a swelling, or mainly for acute conditions.
Understood.
However, now patients come to me much more often for regular preventive visits, or really a lot of pediatricians or a lot of dentists are referring patients to me at a very early age wherein we can begin a good preventive care. So I can see the transition, but the acceptance was there. And I was happily
surprised. It is good to hear that.
Yes.
So now you told it requires a specialty practice. Now imagine there's a young BDS out there who is not able to get an MDS seat in pediatric dentistry, but internally during his BDS or later he realized he likes treating pediatric patients. So what all procedures and till what extent can a general dentist provide pediatric treatment?
Okay, that's a very, very good question and very close to my heart. I have been speaking on pediatric dentistry for general practice for over a dozen years now.
Yes.
And I've conducted more than 50 different workshops on stainless steel crowns, on preventive dentistry, on local anesthesia administration, on child behavior management etc. for general dentists. And one point that I want to emphasize is the onus of treating children will always be on general dentists.
Okay.
Because of the scarcity of pediatric dentists. We are not talking just about metro cities or major cities. There are, I would say below 18 population of India is roughly about 40%.
Yes.
And if we just look at the disease burden, by 5 years of age, about 50% children have tooth decay. Some 8 or 10% children have molar incisor hypoplasia. Anywhere between 5 and 30% is the prevalence of traumatic dental injuries. I'm not talking about the prevalence of oral habits, smile occlusion, and some other conditions. And what is the unmet treatment need? About 90% of or more of the conditions are untreated at the moment. So that means there is such a huge disease burden and there are so few pediatric dentists. And as you correctly said, in my assessment, about 10 to 20% of them are practicing pediatric dentistry as an exclusive specialty.
Yes.
So there is tremendous potential for general dentists also to practice pediatric dentistry. And there are three key things when it comes to practicing pediatric dentistry in a general dental practice. First is you have to believe that you can practice pediatric dentistry as much as you believe that you can practice endodontics or you can practice prostodontics or you can do extractions. Okay. So, I mean, I won't say that a general dentist is adept at doing every extraction of an impacted tooth or something like that, but reasonably good at doing most extractions, reasonably good at doing the routine endodontic treatments, not retreatment or not say severely calcified canals. So a similar expertise can be achieved in pediatric dentistry. The point number two is pediatric dentistry is really not complicated technology. If you learn to do a simple procedure such as putting a stainless steel crown, it suffices most of the extracoronal restorations. Most of the purpose, that's the most widely practiced extracoronal restoration. And it's a small learning curve. So be confident of learning those techniques which are really important. Another example is local anesthesia. If you are able to inject a child well, I often say on a lighter note that dentists are needle phobic. Before the child is scared of receiving an injection, a dentist is often shaky about giving one.
Yes, so, and especially with children worst.
The opposite. Yeah, that's what. So it is I'm confident of injecting a child well, then half the battle is won. So these are a few procedures like local anesthesia, putting stainless steel crowns. They are important to learn. And the third thing is there should be a comprehensive treatment planning. There are three aspects of pediatric dental care: the treatment aspects, preventive care aspects. That's a big domain, very much under the purview of general dentists. And the third is the child management or the behavior management domain. So in the preventive dental care, a good preventive advice, application of Pitt and Fisher sealants or fluoride varnishes, a lot of simple non-invasive procedures of minimal interventional dentistry. So if general dentists learn to practice these things, then pediatric dentistry is not difficult. In fact, 80% of pediatric dentistry is these things.
Understood.
So I suggest that all dentists who are interested must look at this as a great career option.
I understood. So now if someone is thinking, I love pediatric dentistry so much that I want to do MDS in it, is there some behaviors they should have or any characteristics which would make them successful in pediatric dentistry?
In fact, to start with, I told you that even the interest is not an absolute essential or a necessary, because if you are interested, fine, good. But if you are not interested also, you can learn to practice pediatric dentistry. It's an acquired skill basically. So if you have interest, good. If you don't have interest, you can cultivate interest. Doing MDS is good if you have a goal of, I would say MDS, basically post-graduation has three learning objectives. It is your clinical skills. It is your research or academic skills. And third is, if you also want to explore the possibility of teaching the subject, correct? So yes. Post-graduation is a good consideration if you have these goals. If you just want to have good clinical skills, as I said, you can take up short courses, or I had developed a fellowship course in pediatric dentistry, yes, where I was working earlier. And now, again, where I'm working now, we are developing a fellowship program. So a 1 or 2 year of such a program, or good guidance from a pediatric dentist, can also help.
Okay. So someone who is either thinking of exclusively doing pediatric dentistry, or someone who's into research or this, they should think in to get into MDS basically, or teaching.
Yeah, I mean, the MDS is a little wider. You have done MDS, so you know that there is a lot of emphasis on the library dissertation and the main, yes, dissertation. And
so you have to be keen on going through all that also.
Exactly.
Understood. So you started with one pediatric exclusive practice, and then you were working simultaneously, you were able to put multiple clinics, and you were studying all these various qualifications of yours. How were you able to manage, and how was the experience of
putting? Okay, there is a small correction here, that I didn't start all the clinics. Okay. In fact, we developed a franchise concept. That means, okay, myself with two of my friends, one Dr. Bhushan Pustake from Nashik and one Dr. Rahul Chagule from Kolhapur. Both are say 1 or 2 years junior to me. So while I started my practice, I had not really been to any other pedodontist to learn how pediatric dentistry is practiced. And same is the story of these two friends. So we all used to discuss with each other what could be the standard of care that we will be able to do in the practice, what standardization, what protocols we should develop. And we finally came up with a certain system of functioning, a certain experience for a patient that we believed could be replicated. Because we didn't have a model clinic that we followed, we wanted to develop a certain prototype, a certain practice that could be further replicated. And luckily, 3 or 4 more people joined. And that's how we identify ourselves as Little Smiles Pediatric Dental Clinics. So there was another practice that I had started, and one of my students, Dr. Milind Shah, he now, okay, independently runs it. Okay. I don't have any stakes in that. He has, in fact, from day one, he ran that practice. I didn't run that practice.
Okay. But how was your experience starting it in partnership? Making the systems and everything. What were the advantages of
it? Well, the experience is good. I can give you these examples, like Dr. Milind Shah, Dr. Yogesh, who started a practice in Khargar. They did remarkably well in their own practices. In fact, I'm very proud of them the way, and I don't want to really take any credit for that, because it is their practice.
There would be something they might have seen and learned from you, right? Working under you, they might have got the opportunity to see the styles, the technique of treating these patients, managing the clinic.
Well, I can always boast of them as my students, but I don't really want to take any credit away from them.
That's humble of you, sir, as always. One more question I have is, do you think there is any shift in the pediatric dentistry approach? Maybe there's some technique which is coming, or some procedure which might change the field. For example, in orthodontics, you have aligners which are coming in. So something, mm-hmm, is there any change in pediatric dentistry which general dentists need to be aware of, or the practicing pedodontists need to be aware of?
Certainly. In fact, the most important thing that I recommend everyone be aware of is evidence. Because as we know, there is more and more research coming in. About 10 years ago, I didn't practice fluoride varnish applications or sealants or, say, partial excavation and restoration as much as I do now. Because there is more evidence that these techniques are really helpful. Now, another thing that I mentioned in the beginning, that pediatric dentistry is an age-defined specialty. So it is not really a procedure-specific specialty. Although a lot of new things are available, like zirconia. So myofunctional orthodontics is another thing which I have integrated in my practice. And we are treating a lot of mixed dentition cases, or we are treating a lot of patients with interceptive orthodontics. Also, lasers have made it possible to do, say, tongue tie surgeries or minor oral surgeries in a much better way as compared to earlier days. So there are some techniques, there are some tools which are now available.
But so it's slightly become easier to do certain procedures. That's the only difference. Nothing other than that.
Yes, yes. See, pediatric dentistry is not gizmo dentistry. I mean, you don't require any big gadgets. You require, I often say that the driving skills are more important than which cars you drive.
Yeah.
Correct.
Good point.
So if you have good driving skills, cars, I mean, the luxury cars are basically for comfort factor. I mean, you can buy expensive equipment and practice that if that gives you additional comfort. But they don't replace basic skills.
So finally, it is in the hand of the pediatric dentist to mold his patients and his practice.
True.
Sir, is there any parting advice you would like to give to the audience, young dentists out there?
Okay, now this is not related to pediatric dentistry. I just want to talk very briefly about success in practice. And I consider that success is an outcome of three points. Okay, one is, how good are your skills? I'm considering skills over talent. Okay, because you may be talented, but you have to keep upgrading your skills. So that is number one. Then number two is smart work. Again, I am replacing hard work with this term smart work. It doesn't matter how much work you put in. You have to be really focused. You have to be conscious about your effort always. And sometimes delegating work and making someone work for you is also some smart work, right? So it's not just the physical work, because somebody is working in the business, somebody is working on the business.
On the business.
So this kind of a smart work, that is the second point. And the third point is willingness to take some risks. Should I start a practice or should I not? I mean, going out of your comfort zone at times and doing some, exploring these things and taking some risk is essential at some stage in life. So I think the success is an outcome of these three things. How many skills you have and what you make of those skills. And secondly, how much smart work you are putting in. And third thing is, as I said, some risk appetite over the risk potential. You may not have huge risk potential, but you should have some risk appetite. And I together can put all the three things and collectively call them as the right attitude to practice. So if you have a
right attitude to practice, then you can be successful.
Yes.
It was really nice talking to you, sir. I'm sure all the listeners and the viewers would have got a lot of knowledge from it. And every time I meet you, I get to learn something new. You're one of those few people I would like to meet regularly. So I keep increasing my knowledge as well. Thank you for taking your time and being a part of our interview. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for giving me this opportunity, and thank you for all the kind words. And I hope whatever that I have said helps the audience.
100%. I'm sure they'll learn a lot from today's interview. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.